Welcome to Progress in San Diego, Ordinary People Doing Extraordinary Things. I'm your host, Walter Davis. And with me this evening, I have the honor once again to have David Smith of Fair Trade La Mesa. I almost say free trade every time, and that's just so hard. And that's because we're ingrained to believe that free trade is a good thing. And so, David, welcome to the show. And maybe we can just start out with that. You know, how we're just conditioned to believe that free trade is a good thing.
Well, it's a good question. What is the difference between fair trade and free trade? I mean, we hear those two terms and they sound very similar, right? I mean, the two adjectives are almost identical. Something's fair, something's free. They're both good things. We like freedom, we like fairness. But the two terms refer to opposite ends of the spectrum when it comes to economics and trade. Free trade, there's actually very little that is actually free in a libertarian economics sense about free trade. But free trade has to do with agreements that countries enter into with each other where products and money can flow freely across the border between those countries. So the most close to home example of free trade would be NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, which was between Canada, the United States, and Mexico. And so as part of that agreement, it allowed for, to a certain extent, it allows for products and money and things to flow across the borders between those countries. It also allows for jobs to be relocated. So after NAFTA was signed in 94, a lot of jobs, a lot of factories were shut down. A lot of jobs were lost to workers in the United States, and those factories moved to Mexico, moved to set up shop on the northern border of Mexico. And so in that sense, there was free movement of things across the border, but there was a lot that was not free about the North American Free Trade Agreement. There's a lot that was actually the opposite of what you would think of as free trade if you think about just letting trade happen. That is not the case with NAFTA. One example of that, a huge example, is all the subsidies that the U.S. government continues to pour into our huge factory farms, into big, massive corn farmers, not small mom-and-pop corn farmers, but huge corn farmers that are producing huge amounts of corn for massive corporations like Coca-Cola, mm-hmm. et cetera. Under NAFTA, we keep on subsidizing our corn farmers. But for Mexico to enter into NAFTA, Mexico was required to take away its subsidies for its own small producers and its own smallholder corn farmers. And so the result of that was that you have this lopsided agreement. So it's not like a marriage between two equal partners who are coming together. It's more like a marriage between a huge, ugly gorilla and a little bunny rabbit. What is that gorilla going to do to that bunny rabbit in that marriage? I don't want to think about it. That's what NAFTA looks like if we look at the nitty-gritty of that free trade agreement. Another big part of that is NAFTA allows for the free passage of money, products, things that people make in Mexico and Canada and the U.S. It allows those things to move across the border. It does not allow people to cross that border, though. So what do you have? You've got an agreement where this huge border exists and it's militarized and there's all kinds of scary drone planes and there's all kinds of barbed wire and fences on that border for human beings, but not for money. Not for products, and not for the things that those human beings in Mexico are producing. Not for the thousands of maquiladora workers in northern Mexico who are working in these factories, often under sweatshop conditions. There's all kinds of horrible conditions exist in these assembly line factories, and I've personally met a lot of people who work or have worked in these factories, mm-hmm. people who've suffered from chemical poisoning, women who gave birth to children with birth defects, mm-hmm. People who suffered on the worksite accidents in these maquiladora sweatshops. And so those people are allowed to work in Mexico. They're allowed to put together electronics, put together tennis shoes or whatever. Those electronics, those products are allowed to cross the border, mm-hmm. but the people cannot cross the border.
Before we move further, I want to hold that thought. I want to hold the thought about people, border, porous money. I want to come back to that. But let's go back to the gorilla bunny rabbit thing. Because some people may just look at the workers in Mexico, per se, the people there to be the bunny rabbit, the small guys. However, we all are that bunny rabbit because we're right. all being taken advantage of in this scheme of things, are we not?
Absolutely. All working people are being taken advantage of through free trade agreements. I mean, getting it mixed up myself. So through free trade agreements, it's really making saps out of all of us working folks, wherever we are. NAFTA was amazing because it managed to harm working folks in all three countries, in Canada, in the U.S., and in Mexico. And it lowered wages and lowered conditions for working folks in all three of those countries.
And at the same time, the wealthy farmers are getting government subsidies. So they're talking about cutting back on Medicaid for seniors. They're talking about cutting back on education programs. Yet these wealthy farmers, and some of these people are basketball stars, right? Mm-hmm. Some of these people are movie stars. Some of them are wealthy owners of corporations. These are wealthy people that are getting government subsidies while working people are being injured.
Exactly. And the same thing has happened with the rich in Mexico, as a matter of fact, too. A lot of new millionaires and billionaires sprung up as a result of NAFTA. One of the richest men in the world, possibly the richest man in the world, Carlos Slim, he lives in Mexico. He's a Mexican man.
He's the one that owns the telephone company, right?
Right.
He is the richest man. Well, he was, last time I saw, the richest man in the world.
Yeah, I think it depends on how they measure that.
Forbes, they indicated. Yeah.
But yeah, he made his killing off of NAFTA. And a lot of the companies, state-run companies in Mexico, were then privatized and passed over into private hands. And so Mexico has a huge number of millionaires and billionaires. And so the rich in Mexico, in Canada, in the U.S., wherever they are, they're doing all right. The rich are doing just fine for themselves. And working people, as a result of a lot of free trade agreements, are put into competition with each other. So you get an agreement like this, and this moves beyond the U.S., beyond Mexico. There was one famous case, I believe the company was called Activewear, if I'm not mistaken. It was a sportswear company. They used to have their factories in Canada. Workers in Canada were making their sportswear. That factory was shut down. It was moved to Mexico, moved to one of these maquiladora assembly line factories in northern Mexico. And so a lot of thousands of Canadians lost their jobs. The jobs were moved to Mexico. And then they decided they didn't want to pay workers as much as they were paying them in Mexico. So they shut down the Mexican factory and moved it to the Dominican Republic because labor was even cheaper and conditions were even cheaper there. And so what you have here is working people being put into competition with each other. And some people have referred to this as a race to the bottom. Let's see who can offer the cheapest wages, the cheapest work, the lowest conditions, the least amount of benefits. And a lot of times people buy into that. Working people buy into that and begin to see each other as the enemy. Either folks here seeing people in Mexico as the enemy, or seeing immigrants as the enemy, or people in other countries seeing folks in different countries as the enemy. Rather than looking at the big picture of abuse that's going on here.
So the reality is that their farms, these small business owners in Mexico, have been destroyed. And so as a result of that, they are forced to migrate to the United States to look for a better way of life. And in turn, the working population here views them as adversaries.
Right. Yeah, and when you look at immigration, there's an old joke that a young boy in school, his parents are called in for a conference at school. So his parents come in and sit down with the teacher. The teacher says, "Your son's been cheating on his tests." They say, "Well, how do you know that?" They say, well, he sits next to this other boy, Mark, and Mark did very well on his test, and your son got all the same answers that Mark did. I said, "Maybe my son's really smart." They said, "Well, the thing is, on question number 47, Mark put, 'I don't know,' and your son put, 'I don't know either.' And so we know that he was cheating on the test." Now, a lot of people look at immigrants in the same light. A lot of people look at immigrants as somebody who's trying to take something from me, or trying to take something that's not theirs, or trying to copy off of me, trying to copy off my answers. That's not the case. Immigrants are victims of this system that we're looking at just as much as working folks in the U.S., in Canada, in any other country who've lost their jobs, who've seen their factories shut down. Huge factories in the Rust Belt in the United States have shut down because of free trade agreements. And immigrants are the result of that, too. Immigrants who have to leave their hometowns and go somewhere else do so because of policies that are enacted in air-conditioned offices in some other part of the world. And yet, when they come to some other place, and this is bigger than the United States and Mexico, this happens within Mexico, too. I've seen the same dynamic of immigrants being discriminated against, being treated like they're the enemy, being treated like they're less, within Mexico, an internal migration within one country. You have people leaving the countryside, leaving rural towns in Oaxaca, in Chiapas, in states in the south, and moving to the cities for work. Mm-hmm. And I've known, over my short life, I've known thousands of people like that. People who have left the countryside, gone to the city looking for work, And because they come from communities that speak different languages, they come from indigenous native ethnicities, they speak different languages, they have different customs, they look different, they have different culture, and they get to the city and they get treated like they're less. They get treated like a threat sometimes. They get mistreated a lot of the time and they become angry and resentful. You see the same, I saw the same thing happen when I was in Haiti and the Dominican Republic. The Dominican Republic is more developed than Haiti is economically. A lot of migrants from Haiti go to the Dominican Republic. When they get to the DR, they are met with machine guns on the border. The whole border is militarized. The people who do manage to migrate into the Dominican Republic, they get called nasty names. They call them Congo, which is a name referring to the, it's a pejorative term referring to the African ancestry of people in Haiti. And they get called all kinds of horrible racist terms. People from the Dominican Republic often migrate to Puerto Rico because Puerto Rico is more developed and has higher wages. People from the DR go to Puerto Rico and they get discriminated against and they get treated like less and they get talk about where they're from, their accent and everything else. Then people from Puerto Rico migrate to New York or other places and what happens to them when they migrate there. So you have this whole dynamic of migration and of people being treated like the enemy when they do migrate somewhere. And they migrate somewhere the same reason any people migrate at any point in human history looking for better conditions. But in recent years, you've seen a spike in migration. People have always moved back and forth across borders and countries. But in recent years, there are a lot more migrants and a lot more undocumented immigrants in the world. There's millions of people who are immigrants without papers because of economic policies that have been enacted that let corporations make huge amounts of profits by taking advantage of working folks like us.
And so we have this intensely stratified economic system. However, the majority of the people aren't doing that well. A very small percentage of the population is doing well. So we see the thing with the Occupy movement, with the 99% versus the 1%, which is a very real thing. People are tired. People are angry because of this type of system. Now, we had a discussion earlier about your trip to Mexico. You just got back. You spent 2 months down there, right? We're going to talk about that a little bit. And we also want to go into coffee. You said you wanted to talk about some very specific things regarding coffee. So let's get into that. Let's get into the things that are important to you in that conversation.
Sure. I recently went to southern Mexico, and I visited a Mixtec town that I visited 2 times in the past. I also visited some communities that are part of a fair trade coffee cooperative. But I wanted to mention, by way of background, how I got in touch with the Mixtec town that I visited and how I decided to visit that town for the first time, which was years ago. 5 years ago, I visited the town for the first time. I was fascinated by the Mixtec culture. I had friends who were Mixtecs. Also, I had seen the conditions that Mixtec people live in who work on huge factory farms in northern Mexico. And I mentioned that when I was here on your program in the past. I've mentioned some of those conditions, just horrific, sometimes near slavery type conditions that migrant farm workers are living in and working in huge factory farms that are producing vegetables, tomatoes, cucumbers, strawberries for the U.S. market primarily, but they're in Mexico. And so these people leave southern Mexico and they migrate within Mexico. They migrate to northern Mexico and work on these farms, and they are producing fruits and vegetables that get shipped to the U.S. because it's cheaper that way for the big corporations. It's cheaper that way.
Let's seize on that one moment and come back. Now, cheaper for the corporation, we're going to come back to that idea. They can also use pesticides in these areas that they can't use in other countries, and the people are working for slave labor. So these pesticides are getting into the vegetable products that we're eating, and so we're being poisoned. We're eating these pesticides that cannot be sprayed on produce here in the United States, and thus this is leading to the high cancer rates that we have and various diseases that we have. So we are also victimized by this tendency to move production into these other countries and to get around environmental protection laws. And you also mentioned the birth defects. There's a high degree of birth defects in these areas as a result of the homes in the adjoining areas to where the farms are that are being sprayed with the pesticides. Okay, so let's continue.
And I've met people who worked in the fields, and in some conditions, the pesticides are sprayed on the field while people are working in it. And I've met women, pregnant mothers who were working in the fields, and pesticides were being sprayed on human beings while they're working in the fields. And all of this so that we can have the kind of tomatoes that we have for a very cheap price. And so, obviously, as a result, the result is huge, incredible birth defects that these women have in the children they give birth to, rates of cancer, skin diseases, things like that. I've spent time in the encampments that people live in. You've got people packed in, 10 or 12 people in one small room in these barrack-type conditions. Those are the lucky people who actually have a room to stay in. Other people sleep on the ground under a tarp in a little tent. And so it's just these awful conditions. You know, you see kids running around naked with hair that's discolored from malnutrition, distended bellies. And I saw these conditions, and I found out that these people were not native to northern Mexico. They had come from southern Mexico. This was when I was just getting to know the Mixtec people. And the Mixtec culture is an ancient culture, thousands of years old. It predates Spanish and English in the Americas. Mixtec's been spoken here thousands of years before our languages were. And so I was fascinated by that. But I also wanted to know, why would people come in and voluntarily come and live in these conditions? Why would somebody choose to leave their hometown and their community and come to live in a place like this? And so I wanted to get to know it more. So I talked to my friends who are from Oaxaca, which is a state in southern Mexico, and they're from a Mixtec town. I spoke with them, and I asked if I could visit their town. And like many indigenous people in Mexico, these people are extremely hospitable, very open, very friendly. They said, yeah, you can stay with my uncle. Now, when I went to that town the first time, 5 years ago, I was expecting to find just a horrible place. I was expecting to find people living in mud huts and sleeping on the ground in the mud while it rains mud on them and eating mud. I was like, it's got to be so bad for them to leave and go to a place like the factory farms in northern Mexico. And so I rode down with somebody. We took a bus and then rode in the back of a bed of a pickup truck out to the town. And I get there, and it was a beautiful place. It was gorgeous. It was pristine. It was lush. It was verdant countryside. This town is situated right at the top of a mountainside. You have this gorgeous view of dozens of towns in the valley beneath it. It gets dark, and all the different towns light up like constellations in the darkness. And just beautiful view, beautiful, lush countryside there. This is not some stinking desert where you can't grow anything. And I found out that it was the perfect climate to grow coffee, and they had grown coffee for a long time. And so the first obvious question that I ask myself when I see this, I say, why would anybody leave? Why would you leave a place like this and go work for somebody else on somebody else's farm in some other place that's foreign to you? And the reason is economics. The reason has a lot to do with the North American Free Trade Agreement. For a long time, the farmers in this Mixtec town, the town is called San Juan Cuatzospam, and the farmers in this town had farmed coffee. Nobody got rich farming coffee, but for a while there were price controls, and there was a stable price that was maintained. And you knew you would make X amount of pesos by farming coffee. So you knew if you worked hard, you knew how much you would make. And so you and your family and your neighbors, you all got together and you worked on this harvest all year. And there was a guarantee of how much money you would make farming coffee. And then in the years surrounding NAFTA, and around 94 and the years earlier than that, all these price controls were taken away. And so coffee farming became a gamble. Now, the big corporate folks, they knew how much money they were going to make. They knew where the price was going to go. They had access to all this market information. But coffee farmers from towns like Cuatzospam did not. And so after 94, it became a gamble where the price would go up and down, the market price for coffee, and they were on their own. If they didn't want to sell it for a certain price, they were screwed, essentially. And they were dependent on a lot of middlemen, brokers who would come and buy the coffee and sell it to Nestle and Sara Lee and the big players in the coffee market. And so because they knew that some years they would actually lose money, they would come out behind by farming coffee, there was no point in farming coffee. And there was no way to survive. So why do these people leave this beautiful town that is native to them? It's got everything that's dear to them, culturally, personally, their family. Why would they leave that and go work somewhere else? Because they can't work in their hometown. They just can't. They lose out if they stay in their hometown and work there.
So a very good documentary that covers this is a movie called The Lost Mexicans of Deer Canyon. And it shows how Mexican people have been living close to the 56 freeway in North San Diego County, taking showers with irrigation systems there, living in mud and cardboard huts out there in the wilderness area in San Diego County. And some of these same people are working in restaurants like KFC, and they're working in fields here in San Diego County. And it documents how some of these people had rancheros that had been in their home families for hundreds of years, and they were accustomed to growing their own coffee. They were independent. These were middle class and upper middle class people at one time, but they were destroyed. Their farms were destroyed by the NAFTA and CAFTA agreements, and now they're living in cardboard huts here in San Diego County and taking showers using the freeway irrigation system that actually irrigates the plants along the freeway system.
Right.
And drinking that water as well.
Right. Yeah, and I've met a lot of those guys too. And it's just, it's rough conditions those guys are living in. And I mean, you meet people like this and people who've left everything to go work somewhere else. Nobody does that for fun. People do that because they have to. Nobody is going to pick up and leave their family. Even if you and I, if we know that we could make a little more money working for the British pound instead of the dollar, we could make a little more money earning yen in Japan. Even if we knew we could make double, triple our salary, we're not going to leave unless we have to, because we have everything that's dear to us here. Because, and to risk everything, to risk this trek, especially when you're talking about crossing the U.S.-Mexico border, which is a life-threatening trek that you make, because there's no legal way to cross. And folks who get spooked about immigration say, why don't they immigrate legally? The answer is there's no way to do it legally. For people who are, for the vast majority of poor folks from Latin America and other parts of the world, there's just no line to get into. People say, get in line and wait. Where is the line? There is no line. The average wait for any kind of visa for a working class poor person from Mexico, the average is about 187 years. And so, okay, get in line and wait 187 years. So, I mean, what do you do when you see conditions like this? When you've had your hometown devastated by economic conditions and economic policies that are set by these big players somewhere else, and your hometown, your livelihood has been devastated by that, what do you do? Do you sit at home and starve, or do you move somewhere else? You either move somewhere else in within your country, you move to another country to work and try to help your family survive. And that's where fair trade comes into play. Fair trade is about changing all that. The fair trade movement.
Before we go further on fair trade, giving a definition, I want to come back. Definition of fair trade, let's start there. These people are only making $350 a year in some cases.
Right.
So it would take them 10 years to save up enough money. They saved every penny for 10 years. They would then be able to pay the fees they need to immigrate legally into the United States.
And now even that, that's if they had a visa available to them.
Mm-hmm.
Even to be able to pay the fees, there's no guarantee, especially for somebody. There's all kinds of other requirements. I have a lot of friends who come from middle-class backgrounds in Mexico who were not able to get a visa of any kind. And these are because there's all these requirements of having a job, a bank account, all these certain things that most working-class folks do not have. Most folks will never will have those requirements, never will meet them. But I know a lot of people who do meet those requirements and couldn't get the visa. They met all the requirements and paid all the fees and poured $1,000 into it and still didn't get the visa because it's a discretionary matter and the U.S. State Department was in a bad mood that day or whatever and didn't give it to them.
How wonderful is that? Okay. We got 5 minutes, so we're going to just come back to definition of fair trade.
So fair trade, when a product is certified fair trade, what does that mean? First off, it means the product was not produced by somebody who is working as a peon, as a virtual slave, as a peasant on somebody else's farm. It means that that person is part of a worker-owned business. When you see a product that has a fair trade label, the people who produce that product, they own their own business. If it's fair trade coffee, for instance, I mentioned last summer I was down in Chiapas in southern Mexico, and I spent a month volunteering with a fair trade co-op down there named Mayavinique. And this co-op, it's run by the coffee farmers, it's owned by the coffee farmers, it's democratically run by them. They elect a board of directors every couple of years. They all take part in meetings where they make important decisions that are part of the co-op. And it's a total different business model. It's not this corporate top-down kind of business model. It's a model where everybody takes part in the business, and it works. It's very efficient. It's very well run. I was able to see how this works firsthand. Not only do these people own their own business, they're able to negotiate a fair price with the buyers, and they, in many cases, they deal directly with the coffee buyers within Mexico, in the United States, in Japan, in Canada, in Europe, in other countries. And the buyers come and they have this direct deal where they don't have to deal with all these intermediary middlemen and brokers who are gouging them on the price. And so these people, these farmers, they have access to all the different market information of the market price of coffee right now. And they have direct access to the buyers, In many cases, the buyers are from coffee roasting companies in the United States and other countries who really care about buying coffee with a clean conscience. And they really care about buying it directly from the coffee farmers. And so you have a much different kind of trade. And it's a trade, that's fair, it's equitable, and it's also efficient, and it works. And now, these prices are obviously negotiated like in any business transaction. The buyers sit down with the farmers, and they reach an agreement that's mutually beneficial. Nobody's getting gouged. Nobody's coming out on the short end of the deal here. Both of them are sitting down, and they are treating each other as equals in this deal. Another part of the fair trade label, when you see a product that has the fair trade label on it, it means it was produced in an ecologically sustainable way. Pesticides were not used. It did not involve child labor. It means that gender equity was assured within that business as well between men and women. And so you're seeing a product that's fair trade, and you have this guarantee of all these certain conditions for the people who made that product. And so what does that mean in concrete terms? It means that you have towns like the communities in Chiapas that I visited where people all of a sudden do not have to leave their hometown. They don't have to migrate somewhere else. They don't have to go work for someone else in northern Mexico, in a different part of the country, in a different country. They don't have to cross a dangerous border because it's enough. I saw people who made enough farming coffee that they had some of their own side businesses as well.
We are down to the absolute end of our interview now. As usual, the time passes by so quickly. Right. So let's look at doing this again next month and continuing this conversation, okay?
Absolutely.
I appreciate you for coming on the show. Every time you bring such a wealth of information. If you want to get in touch with David and learn more about the fair trade agreements, then please call the number at the end of the broadcast and become involved with the San Diego County Community Coalition. The website will appear at the end of the broadcast. Please contact me and get involved with us in our efforts to stand for human rights, social justice, and the environment. I invite you to come back here every Sunday at 5 p.m. here on Cox, and we're also expanding to Time Warner and other public access channels. And you can also see us on the internet. It's easy to find us there. Again, a website will appear at the end of the broadcast and my telephone number. Please don't hesitate to get in touch with me and to get involved with us for our efforts to make our community a much better place to live. I want to thank you once again for joining us, and thank you once again, David, for being here and bringing in the wealth of information that you always bring to us. Thank you for joining us.